Welcome to the SynthEyes tutorial. Today, we're exploring the parent mesh to tracker feature. This tool allows you to parent a mesh to a 3D solve point so it updates its position each time you solve. Perfect for set extensions, layouts, and other little tasks we'll try in this video. It speeds up your workflow without any complex buttons upon buttons. Let's jump in and see how it works. So here I've got a simple free move shot that should easily show what's going on. I want to block in this building, so I'm going to create a series of boxes. With the box selected, we're going to select a tracker and then come over to Toolbars and open up the Mesh toolbar. If you don't see it, right-click and come over here and check off Mesh. Take note that you have to be in the perspective view to do this. At the bottom, we have Parent Mesh to Tracker. And what that's going to do is it's going to literally parent the geometry under the tracker. And to see this actually happen, we're going to open up the hierarchy view where we'll scroll down and be able to see the tracker and the mesh. And once I click the button, it's going to hop underneath, but the mesh did not move. So if you want it to move to update its position, you're going to have to use the shift key. So with both of them selected, I'm going to hold shift and then click the button again, and now you can see that the mesh has zeroed out its translations under the solve point. You are allowed to freely offset this mesh underneath the tracker, but I'm going to be doing that later. For now, I just want the origin of this cube to snap to the tracker. And in this instance, I want to move the pivot. I want to move my object's origin over to one of the top corners to represent the corner of the building. So I've hit Control P on my keyboard to go into this Edit Pivots mode and have now adjusted. It snaps to the vertice. And if you can't find the Edit Pivots button, you can find it under GOH track here. And now that I've got my object's pivot moved and my tracker selected, I can click my parent button and there we go. I want to immediately add another box, but I don't want to move the pivot again, so let's duplicate this one. And while it's selected, I'll grab my other tracker and just hit parent again. I like to repurpose my shapes just to speed things up a little. I'd like to add a couple extra surfaces in this video, so let me quickly toss a point that I trust on this building over here. And my point is added, so let's head over to the 3D room and drag in a plane. And with the two of those selected, we'll hit parent again. And now that I've got a few pieces of geometry to make this actual solve a little bit more visible, let's do a little bit of cleanup here, make some things a little brighter. And now let's get ready for a solve. So I'm just going to quickly add some constraints so that when I hit calculate, we should be able to see a clear view of this feature and what it's doing. And now, Shift-G to solve, and magic. Personally, I love that my meshes just snapped into position. Helps me get a quicker view of my layout and means I don't have to move my geometry every single time. You can see how drastically that my geometry shifted in space to realign with my 3D solve points. Now you can see there's some problems with my distortion and also the perspective in various parts of my shot is a little bit funky. The nice part about having our meshes snap into position is that I can go and make changes like adjusting my solver mode, turning constraint on, and adding in some distortion parameters that I should have had from the beginning in retrospect. If you'd like to learn more about these things, watch the dedicated tutorials on the Boris Effects website. Much better. Once again, you can see how everything snapped into position, and I can check my perspective at a glance and quickly keep iterating. I now want to add another box to represent the portion of the building on the left side of the screen. As per usual, I'll have my mesh selected along with a tracker of my choosing, come over to the mesh toolbar, and parent. I'll do a little scale and adjustment of my geo just so I can check the perspective and see what's going on. See if things are actually lining up, which I can already see they are not. An annoying thing in any layout or tracking software is realizing, oh, I have to move it again for the 20th time. So let's add a tracker and link it over as a Z-axis and resolve. Wow, more magic. Once again, see how everything adjusted. And you can see how the larger my scene gets, the more that making slight adjustments and having everything just work is quite time-saving. Now I've noticed something a little funny. you can see the left box and the right box are kind of sitting on the same planar depth as each other, which is wrong. I'm going to have to adjust this, and I'm going to do it by adding another tracker on the glass portion and then link them just to give a little bit more data to the surface and let these boxes snap into the correct depth that they should be at. And hit it with another solve, and let's compare. Look at that. That brings joy into my life. What doesn't bring me joy is seeing that the y-axis on that building on the far left edge is still a little bit screwy, so I'm going to add another point and add another constraint and do another solve. This is an example of iterating, because if I check my distortion, you can see that I didn't actually check on any real distortion that matters. So we turned it on, played around with a couple of parameters, we solved, and the geometry is all snapping itself back into position. I've said it too many times, but it makes me happy. I'm going to spend a little bit of time adding in a couple more pieces of geo. So let me quickly block in this plane, do a little scale adjustments on the other boxes, and add a tracker up here so I can toss this big cylinder in. And now, as per routine, we will parent mesh to tracker. See that my scene was a little bit too small. There we go, we can see, now adjust. And a last look at everything together. I want to take a few more minutes to look at a couple extra things. So let's say you solved your shot and the depth isn't as spot on as you'd hoped. If I were to take this guy and put him back here, let's say he's taller than this man or shorter than this man. And we want to adjust the focal length, but you know, we're going to have to keep moving this guy to readjust for the new position. Let me quickly duplicate him and parent him over there. Duplicate mesh. Now I've got this boy. And just for fun, I'm not going to use the parent button. Let's just drag him under the tracker. 18 it happens to be. Wait, is it? Oops, is it not that one? What's this tracker? Oh, it's that one. Drag him right there. See, easy enough to drag and drop your mesh around your scene. I swear that was planned. And you can come over to 3D and right click and clear out the translations. There we are. And you can see that my boy is a little bit short. If I look in the quad view, you can see where we're sitting. So if this wasn't parented, let's drag it out real quick. We'll have to move it, as I mentioned. So if I take these two points here, in which I have a distance constraint set. By the way, I also have a distance constraint right here at the beginning to lock the scale of our midground. So if I take our distance constraint back here and start adjusting it, let's say it's on 150, let's make it 175. Solve. You can see that our points have updated their position. But now I gotta take and drag this around, and I don't want to do that. So let's undo. Bring that parent back. Is it 20? Yes, it is. And then solve. Look at that. Our person has moved along with the tracker, and you can see over here in the camera view that we've affected the scale of the background without harming the foreground. So I'm going to take that distance and drop it back. Let's go 120. Let's see. Better. 110. Even better. He seems like he's a little hunched over. Also, it should be a little taller anyway. 100. Sure, I like it. And you can see in the front view here, our person jumping around. And that would be it for using parenting alongside distance constraints. Next thing is offsetting. So, first let me put a box to represent this building here. And same thing as usual, I'm going to move its pivot. And grab our tracker. Mesh. Shift parent. and scale it up. Easy building. Let's just scale it up this way first. A little bit. There we go. And now I'm going to bring in another piece of geometry. Nice big SynthEyes text. So now that I have this, I'm realizing my SynthEyes scene scale is a little bit crazy. Let's throw in a little dude for scale. And I'm going to parent him to this tracker on the ground. So he's too big. I should have put a point over by his feet, but I'm not going to be too meticulous with this shot. So I'll grab the point that I used for scale, which is this one over here, where I manually locked it to negative 400 on Z. So if I increase that distance, this guy should shrink. Let's pretend he's fine, and look over here. So you can see our boxes change scale, but it stayed snapped at the point. And our SynthEyes text has moved. And you can see it didn't maintain its depth. We can scale this box back up into position easily, but the text, we gotta move it around and it's just time. So let's select our text and grab one of these trackers, parent, and now let's position it at whatever depth we please. Place it where we want. And great, now whenever I adjust the scale of my shot, you can see that the text is now at least staying within the same depth of the point. So eventually, if we want to, all we ought to do is do a little nudge left and right. Scale it up if we want. Takes out a little bit of the work. But offsetting just lets you freely move your geometry around underneath the trackers. And that's it for our look at parent mesh to tracker. With just a couple clicks, you can link your meshes to your trackers, making sure your geometry stays in sync with your scene's motion, and saving you a bunch of time in the process. Hope you give it a try in your next project.